The lady, right after the lady could be a good evening. Now that Advent's over, I'm almost getting used to that program. Thank you very much.
As I looked over this reading that was given to us today, being 2020, the words that we're going to read out of the scripture and writings here are really, really rough. Light the first three candles of the Advent wreath, the candles of hope, peace, and joy. Now we light the fourth candle of Advent. This is the candle of love. Jesus demonstrated self-giving love in his ministry with his children. Advent is a time of kindness, thinking of others, and sharing with others. It's a time of love as God loved us and given us his most precious gift. As God is love, let us be love also. In the book of Deuteronomy, we find these words.
For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who is not partial and takes no bribe, who executes justice for the orphan and the widow, and who loves the strangers, providing them food and clothing. You shall also love the strangers, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt.
From the New Testament, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I loved you. You also should love one another. But this By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, as you have loved for one another. John 13, 34, 35. Let us pray.
Teach us to love, O Lord. May we always remember to put you first as we follow Christ's footsteps, that we may know your love and show it in our lives. As we prepare our celebration of Jesus' birth, also fill our hearts with love for the world. That all may know your love and the one whom you have sent, your Son, our Savior, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Let's sing together. Oh, come thou who art
Emmanuel. To bring
sing. Just that chorus. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Thank you for your singing. Such a beautiful season, and there's so many beautiful songs that speak about the whole gamut of what Christmas is. And you know, and I know, that Christmas is about joy and excitement and miracles. Christmas is also about terrible sadness and sorrow. And I'm very thankful for Christine and her gift of music, and she's going to share with us a very special song this morning. We continue with the Christmas story from the Gospel of Matthew, Today we're going to be sharing the verses 19 through 23 of chapter 2. And I'll entitle this message, Bringing Someone Home. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt. Get up, the angel said. Take the child and his mother back to the land of Israel, because those who were trying to kill the child are dead. So Joseph got up and returned to the land of Israel with Jesus and his mother. But when he learned that the new ruler of Judea was Herod's son, Archelaus, he was afraid to go there. Then after being warned in a dream, he left for the region of Galilee. So the family went and lived in a town called Nazareth. This fulfilled what the prophets had said. He will be called a Nazarene. May God bless this word to our hearing this morning. So when we last left Mary and Joseph and the newborn baby Jesus, they had traveled down to Egypt to escape from Herod. An angel, we're told, awakened them in the middle of the night and told them to run for their lives. They did arrive in Egypt, and there was a large contingency of Jewish folks there. And so Mary and Joseph found a place to stay and weather the storm until everything was safe again. The angel had said to Joseph to stay in Egypt, quote, until I tell you to return. So this meant that the angel was planning to return to Joseph and let him know when the coast was clear to return home. And we read in today's text that indeed God did that. You know, I never cease to be amazed at how our Heavenly Father looks out for us. Have you ever thought of the number of times God has protected you, has watched out for you, has gone ahead of you, has laid a foundation for you so that things would be easier than the other road you could have taken? We were in the first service in Germany Hill this morning, and we were hearing about a family, a little children in the car, I think, on these bad roads, got into a car crash. And a terrifying moment for the family, but God protected everyone in that car, and they all came out of it safely. God has a way of protecting those that he loves, amen? And we are grateful for his protection over Mary and Joseph as they were taking care of this baby who would be the salvation of the entire world. And so this next section picks up then with the angel who keeps his word and lets the Holy Family know that Herod is now dead and it is time to return home. Now, today in this message, I want to make application in this short text today about three simple points. And these are three things that I see in the text, and I see them in the life of Mary and Joseph and Jesus. But listen, I also see these in every human life. I think that these three things we're going to talk about are a part of everybody's story. At one time or another, these things are going to play out in your life, and they have, and they will again. And so here are the three things I want to share. Number one, there comes a time when you realize that you can't stay any longer in the place where you are. There comes a time when you realize you can't stay any longer in the place where you are. You ever been there? Have you ever found that a situation that you had been in was simply untenable? Realizing that what you did may have worked for a while, it was good for a while, it worked out, but now all of a sudden it's not working now. And so something has to change. Sometimes it's about relationships. Sometimes relationships change. Sometimes our job situation changes. Sometimes it happens with a place where you're living or a situation that you're living with. But the realization comes to you that this cannot continue any longer. For Mary and Joseph, that realization came while they were living in Egypt, which is the land of idolatry, a million different gods to choose from. Remember, they had only gone there in the first place because of an emergency situation. They were trying to escape with their lives from Herod. But now that situation had changed. Herod was dead and Egypt, literally, was not home. Egypt was a temporary solution, not a permanent residence. And the same thing, if you remember, had been true in Israel's history. When Jacob came down to Egypt to be reunited with his son Joseph, it was an emergency situation then as well. We remember that there had been a drought in the land of Israel for 2 years, and Joseph had prophesied there's going to be 5 more years of drought in the land. There's going to be no food. Dad, bring everybody and come down here and live with me. And so Jacob brought all of his family, which ends up being the nation of Israel, small as they were back then, it's only 70 persons, but they all came down to Egypt and survived in a time of emergency. Joseph, you'll see, was the reason that Israel moved his family to Egypt. And now Jesus is the reason that Mary and Joseph moved to Egypt. But watch this. Once Joseph died, once he died, things changed for Israel. The mistreatment then began under the pharaohs that followed, and finally then slavery for the people of Israel. And the realization came to the entire nation, this is no longer working, this is not good, we've got to get out of here. And the people cried out to God, and we know that God sent Moses, and the rest is history. Notice it changed when Joseph died. Notice that in the case of Mary and Joseph, once Herod died, their situation changed as well. The angel brought the news, and it was time for this family to go home. You know, I think every person faces many Egypt type of situations in their lifetime. There are times when we get restless, or times when something isn't working anymore, and we realize it's time to make a change. Many times, situations in life force us to make those changes. But it's a part of every life. Here's number two this morning. Number two is the search for a safe place to call home. We all search for that, don't we? A safe place to call home. Where are we going to settle? You know, in recent weeks, there have been a number of deaths happening around us. It's tragic, but it seems to happen that way every year, about this time of year. Have you noticed that? Some people get diseases, find themselves in a body that will no longer function. The body gets diseased. It may be cancer, it may be diabetes, it may be some other disease, heart disease. But the soul within that person has to get out. They have to leave the body because staying in that body is no longer possible. The body deteriorates and dies. But where do we go? Where do we go when the body that we inhabit is no longer able to hold our soul? Well, we're told in the scripture that we have a choice. And may I just say this morning, the reason we have a choice is because Jesus came here. Amen? That is the joy of Christmas. He came here to give us a choice. Hallelujah. But we all have a choice between two destinations, and it's all based on what we do with Jesus Christ. What we do with this sacrificial death for us. Those who long for God's forgiveness for their sins, they will find it in the person of Jesus Christ. But those who live self-righteously, those who think that they're going to stand before God and set him straight on how good they've been, those who try to justify themselves, they will one day find that they are not the one in control. That God is the one in control. And that to ignore or to flat out reject his offer of forgiveness and eternal life will leave them only with a consolation prize of eternal misery. Let me just say this morning, there are some places you don't want to live in this earth. And there are some places you don't want to live in eternity. And so we seek, don't we? Whether it's here or there, now or then, here or there, we seek for a safe place. And so when Mary and Joseph got the word that Herod was dead, they headed back home toward Bethlehem.
But they soon found out that even though Herod was out of the picture, his son Archelaus was ruling over Bethlehem now. And that left Joseph and Mary with kind of an empty feeling in the pit of their stomachs. Not only that, but Mary and Joseph were aware that all of those little boys from the town of Bethlehem were killed. And it was all because of their little boy. And somehow all of that did not set very well. And so we're told that an angel actually spoke to them again and told them, no, it's time to go back to your home. It's time to go back to Nazareth. It's time to go back to your families. This would be far enough north of the Galilee that it would not be noticed by Herod's son, Archelaus. And so Mary and Joseph went to someplace safe. I'm here to say this morning that there is an eternal place of safety for every human being. Anyone who will turn to Christ will discover that place of refuge and safety from all of the evils and the darkness of this world. We have a place ready for us, a place where we will dwell safely with Christ for all of eternity. That, you see, is the promise of the Word of God, and God always keeps His promises. Amen? And that leads us this morning then to our third statement, and that is simply this one. We long when we find a safe place to be able to bring others to safety as well. We want to bring someone home with us. And so notice that Mary and Joseph, they had been away all this time and there in Egypt and traveling and now back home. It was so good to reconnect. They were home again to all the things that were familiar. It's nice to have a little town like Canada to live in. Amen? This is your home, or your home is one of the little towns that's around here. Let me just say, isn't it nice to have things familiar? You know where the post office is. You know where the doctor's office is. Both of those are right around the corner from me, the doctor and then the post office. And the bank is right there across the street. And everything's close by. It's so nice. It's so handy. And it's so familiar. You know, you get to know people. It's a nice thing to be from a little town. And so here are Mary and Joseph. They go back home. And they're there with their family, the people that they know. Everything is familiar. It's their family, their friends, their house of worship. They're able to be back with the people who worship with them. And all of this, you see, brought them great comfort, didn't it? But Mary and Joseph, notice that they did not come home alone. No, they brought someone home with them. Someone who changed their lives. Someone who's coming to earth sent shockwaves into the spiritual realm. They've seen it from the night he was born. Jesus had barely come out of the womb when the impact in the spiritual realm was felt in the celestial realm as well as the terrestrial realm. Angels had been tapped to come down from heaven and announced his birth to the shepherds. The wise men followed this star that led them right to his manger bed. And it was Herod the king who was shocked to hear another king was in town. And he had to put a stop to that. And he sent his soldiers out to destroy this kingdom before it would ever be established. And we find that the word of the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled in verse 15 of chapter 31, where he said, this is what the Lord says, a cry is heard in Ramah, that little part just north of Bethlehem. A cry is heard in Ramah, deep anguish and bitter weeping. Rachel weeps for her children, refusing to be comforted, for her children are gone. They're just gone. Is it any wonder then that Jesus would later describe his own ministry with these words? He said, don't imagine that I came to bring peace to the earth. I came not to bring peace, but a sword. I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Your enemies will be right in your own household. Jesus is coming, you see. It brought a seismic shift in the spiritual realm. And that earthquake only deepened the divide between those in the kingdom and those outside the kingdom. And maybe you've experienced some of that in some of your families. But you see, only those who remain faithful to their calling will have the blessing of bringing someone home with them to paradise as they share what Christ has done in their life. Pastor John Corson shares the story of some men who took a stand for Christ many years ago in the days of the Roman Empire, in the day when it was very dangerous to take a stand for Christ. The story is told that in the first century when Hadrian was emperor of Rome, Hadrian had waged war against the Christians in the empire, and there were a group of about 40 men, and they were worshiping together. And on that day of worship, some of these soldiers surrounded them, and they said to them, "Upon order of the emperor, your worship of this so-called king of the Jews must cease immediately, or you will be executed. What would you do?" Well, it was a moment you find out what you really believe, don't you? These 40 answered, and they said, "Do what you will, even if it costs our lives." So the Roman soldiers took them into a mountainous region. It was winter time, and the small lake in the area was completely frozen over. The captain of the guard said, "I'm going to give you one more chance to deny Jesus Christ and be saved, or we will place you on that lake all night until your bodies freeze. It is better to freeze for a night than to burn in hell for eternity," answered the brave believers. And so the 40 believers took their places on the ice, and with their teeth chattering and their knees knocking, they began to sing together, "40 brave soldiers for Christ, 40 brave soldiers for Christ," as the Romans looked on and mocked them. Occasionally the captain would call out, "Come to your senses, men. Deny Jesus just for a moment. Come and be warmed by the fire and be saved." But the believers would not budge, and they continued singing, 40 brave soldiers for Christ. And after an hour or so, one of the men who was in that group, he could stand the pain no longer. And finally he ran off of the ice. He ran to the soldiers and he said, "I will deny Jesus Christ." And he was welcome to be warmed by the fire. He found that he couldn't pay the price, and he turned his back on the Babe of Bethlehem. Let me say to you this morning, you who give your lives to Jesus Christ, know this. It may cost you to follow Jesus Christ. It may result in a division among your family, and I'm not talking about you leaving them physically, but about the pain of their inability to understand where you're at or what you're doing. Many parents this day, I say this sadly, many parents would rather have their children smoke pot than come to church. You're not becoming a Jesus freak, are you? Anything but that. There will be a division among friends. The sword comes, and suddenly the group you hung out with is no longer so inclined to include you in their plans. "What happened to you?" they say. "You used to be so much fun. Now look at you." And there will also be a division in the flesh. For if you are truly sincere about following this Babe of Bethlehem, your flesh must die. And the flesh doesn't die easily. It screams and it cries, "Satisfy me." But you who are serious must say, "No, the sword has come. I will no longer give in to my fleshly impulses and desires. I will not be dominated by my flesh, by the sins of this sick society." If you live for your family, if you live for your friends, For if you live for your flesh, you will lose everything. But if you will give up your life and say, Lord, I'm following you. I'm dying to self. Let the sword strike where it will. Then, my friend, you will find life. Some might ask this morning, well, Pastor, really, what good could you do dying? Well, remember those 40 believers on the lake in northern Italy? After one of their brothers left and turned away, they continued to sing. Only they changed the lyric of their song. And they began to sing, 39 brave soldiers for Christ. 39 brave soldiers for Christ. But in that moment, one of the Roman soldiers who was observing this scene was so moved by their passion that he suddenly ran out upon the lake and he said, no, brothers, 40 dear soldiers for Christ, 40 brave soldiers for Christ. You see, that's the irony of Christianity. The more you die, the more you live. Follow the babe of Bethlehem. Follow him. Yes, there will be weeping. Yes, there will be sorrow. Jeremiah 31:15 promised it. But here's the amazing thing about Jeremiah 31:15. It's immediately followed by Jeremiah 31:16 and 17. Now let me read those verses. But now this is what the Lord says. Do not weep any longer. For I will reward you, says the Lord. Your children will come back to you from the distant land of the enemy. There is hope for your future, says the Lord. Your children will come again to their own land. So, church, I say to you this morning, I don't want us to be confused about what all this is. There is a price to be paid to follow Jesus Christ. Many of you already know this. Some of you sitting here, you've already paid a very high price. Some of you are fighting against things that other people don't even know about. And you're standing bravely like those 40 soldiers did, and you're saying, I'm not going to give in, I'm not going to back down, I'm going to keep standing. Listen, may God strengthen you and empower you with His Spirit to keep standing. Because in standing, you will find your life. And you will find continued hope. But I'm here to tell you, church, that the coming of Jesus is just around the corner. Very soon it's all going to be over. And I'm here to tell you that very good things are coming. You who have paid the price and taken up the cross, refrain from weeping. There will be hurts, there will be sorrows. But the blessings that you have presently and the blessings that are on the way cannot be counted or numbered. God is with you. He is on your side. And He comes to set captives like us free and to free us from the pain of this world and the sorrows of this life. The blessings, church, that are coming are far greater than the temporary suffering we have now. They really are. So we give praise to God for that. But let me ask you today. Today, will you give your heart and your life to Jesus Christ? Maybe you're looking at your life and you're saying, it's true. I know I can't stay where I am forever. I can't stay here any longer. I've got to make a change. It's true. I need a safe place to come home to. And so I say to you this morning, will you come to Him? Will you come to Him? And if you will come, and if you will pay the price, who might you bring home with you? May God be praised as we seek to be faithful to Him in an hour when there is much trouble brewing.
May God be friends. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you so much for your word and for the hope you continually bring us. We thank you, Lord, that there was a season when you told Mary and Joseph and the baby, run for your life, get out of here. But then there was another season. And that first season, we're called to run. The Apostle Paul said, run your race with patience. And so we patiently endure. We endure insults. We endure family who castigate us and ostracize us. We endure friends who no longer want anything to do with us. We endure the sadness and the evil and watching lives and souls being destroyed. We endure it all because we know, Father, that after our race is run, the word from God will not be run. It will be come. Come home. Come home to the place I've prepared for you. Are you ready to go today? If this were the day when the trumpet were to sound and the dead were to be raised and the saints were to be caught up to be with Jesus, would you go? Or would you be left behind to face an interminable time of suffering and sadness? I pray that your heart is ready. I pray that you belong to Jesus Christ, and if you don't, let today be the hour when you simply come to Jesus and say, Lord, I'm a sinner needing a Savior. Come and save me. If you can save anyone, if you can do it, and I know you can, then save me. I'm sorry for my sins, Lord. I surrender all to you. Come and save me. Father, for any to pray that prayer from their heart, you have already reached from heaven to touch their soul, and I pray that they will experience the peace and the joy that you came to earth to give us. Help us to be faithful until the time when you return. We ask it in Christ's precious name. Amen. Let's stand together, please, and sing our closing song together. In the week,
yeah.
knowing that you are the call. You are the call. The Christians, the little Christs, the ones who leave this place to make his name known in this world. They never remember us at all. There's no loss at all in that. But oh, that they would remember his name. May his name be upon your lips this day. For the sake of the lost of this world. And for the greatness of our King. Go in peace. Amen.